Good morning, and welcome to Trinity United Methodist Church. It's so nice to see all of you here. Take a moment to let us know that you're here by filling out the red pew pad located at the end of your pew. And if you are new or visiting with us, welcome. We're glad to have you. Take some time to fill out the blue visitor information card. This collects a little bit of information about you, helps us get to know you better, and hopefully to stay in touch. I'd also like to extend a warm welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us via our live stream. We are glad that you've joined us for worship today. As always, children are a welcomed and necessary part of our worship together. There is a table located in the back full of activities for kids, and you are invited to visit that table at any point during today's worship. If you're looking for prayer request cards or offering envelopes, you can find those at each of the sanctuary entrances. And then finally, I'd love to invite all of you to join us for coffee hour. That is a time of conversation and fellowship that immediately follows worship, and you can find that in Asbury Hall, located at the other end of this floor. Excuse me. We do have a couple of announcements this morning. First is that we've got Chapel Kids at Night happening tonight at 5 o'clock, followed by Sunday Night Youth Fellowship, which starts at 6 o'clock. I'd love to see a bunch of folks here for that. Bible Scholars is starting on April 14th. It will run for 4 consecutive weeks during the 9 o'clock hour on Sundays. This is a program for any 3rd, 4th, or 5th grade students who have not yet participated in Bible Scholars. If you would like for your child to participate in this program, please come see me or send me an email or give me a call. There is a church conference scheduled for Sunday, April 14th, and all members, church members, are invited to attend. That will happen following worship that morning. And then I'd like to invite up Gary Stone to make an announcement on behalf of the Missions Committee.
Good morning, everybody. This is a sign of spring for me. Every year when I come up and I talk about Green and Fit and Revitalize CDC, we know the good weather is coming. This year, Green and Fit is going to take place on Saturday, April 27th. We're going to be working on homes in the Memorial Square neighborhood in Springfield. We were there last year, if some of you remember being part of that group. It was so well received there, we continue to look for people in need in those neighborhoods, and they really welcomed us into their homes so that we can get back in there again this year. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with Revitalize CDC, used to be Rebuilding Together Springfield. We bring homes back to livable conditions. The people's homes that we work on are the elderly, low-income families with children, people with disabilities, and military families, and they all qualify for the benefits of our hard work. Trinity Missions has been supporting and participating in this event for the last 12 years. I was so moved by it back then on that very first mission trip that I've been on the board of Revitalize for 12 years, and we appreciate your continued help. Now, there'll be 12 houses in that neighborhood. Trinity has been assigned 2 of the houses, and they're both on Chapin Terrace, and they're right across from each other. So we're gonna gather as a team. I've got a list of repairs and work that needs to be done, and we're going to divide and conquer and really help these people out there this year. Don't worry, there's no skills required. If you can show up and participate at all, we'd really appreciate you being there. We thank you for your support. We do things like yard work, painting, minor house repairs, and they tend to need a lot of landscaping. So we really clean up the yards and we do some planting. All you really need is just a desire to help people in need, and that's what we do. The pep rally and registration, they start at 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturday, and then we will promptly disperse and go out to the homes. We will work from 9 o'clock till 1 o'clock that day. We ask you to try to sign up as early as possible because MGM provides lunches for all of us that day. Water, snacks, granola bars, things like that will all be provided. And it helps us if we can get a head count as early as possible. That will really help our committee. I'll be back here again on, a couple of weeks from now, I think, as a reminder again, to answer any other questions. But you can register on the website. Thank you, Clara Lee, for putting it there for us to review, and also for the step-by-step instructions. You'll see it listed in the carillon, also in the bulletin. It's a great opportunity for us, again, to join together as a team, really put our faith to work, and help people in need in our local community. We hope to see you there.
Thanks, Gary. Now, let's ready our hearts and minds for worship by enjoying this morning's prelude.
Ever-present God, who proved that love is always with us on the first Easter 2,000 years ago, annually we rejoice in the new life you give us. Help us to remember this as Easter grows distant, and to carry and reflect your light year-round wherever we go. In the name of the risen one we pray, amen.
Morning. Please stand as you're able and join me in the call to worship. Where is this Jesus, the one that you call Messiah?
Christ is risen. Christ is here among us.
I do not see him. I do not believe you.
Christ is risen. Christ is here among us.
Let me see his body, his hands, and his feet.
We are Christ's body. We are Christ's feet.
You see the suffering in the world. Where is Jesus now?
We are going into the world to be the body of Christ.
Let us go together. Let us partner with others. For we are the body of Christ. Let us share the good news. Please remain standing and join us in the hymn in the hymnal on page 318, Christ is Alive. Thank you.
remain standing as we join together in our prayer of confession as it is printed in your bulletins. Almighty One, we know you desire to seek it. With all of our hearts, we confess the times that we have misunderstood that doubt is a part of faith, and we confess the times we have discouraged others from questioning what they've been taught. Help us to embrace the challenges to the journey together through the struggles, living with the mystery that is faith, for you are both known and unknown, seen and unseen, creator of the universe, and also within our heart. Help us, O God, to embrace doubt as a part of faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord did not abandon Thomas to his unbelief, nor will the Lord abandon us to ours. God hears the cries for help and answers. God knows how we struggle to believe what we can't see or touch. Know that our invisible God makes forgiveness visible in our hearts and souls. See God at work in your life from this day forward. Now trust your spiritual sight more each day. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And the people said, Amen. Would you please be seated? And now would you please rise in body or in spirit and please pass the peace of Christ to those around you.
Peace to you.
Peace.
I'd like to invite any kids who are with us to come down and join me on the steps for a children's moment. Hello. Hello. How are you?
Good.
Good. Hello, my friends. How's it going? Pretty good? Well, I've had only one thing that I wanted to talk to you all about, and it happened. Oh my gosh, what day did it happen? Did anyone feel that earthquake?
Oh yeah!
Did you? No? All right, let's take a poll. Raise your hand if you felt the earthquake. Okay, raise your hand if you did not feel the earthquake. What about out here? Who felt it? Okay, all right. I felt it. Do you want to know where I was? I was right here at Trinity United Methodist Church. I was up in my office working hard, mind you. And then suddenly I started to feel, what would you call it, like a rumble? And I was sort of like, whoa, 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 whoa. And then I thought, it's an earthquake. So I saw on TV once that you're supposed to get in a door frame. This is not advice, I don't know if that's actually true, but I ran to the door frame and I shouted, earthquake! And Doreen was like, she works upstairs with me, and she was like, oh my gosh, did you feel that? And I was like, yes, did you feel that? Because at first, you want to know how I felt? I thought, am I going nuts? Because all of a sudden, I'm shaking around. It made me feel kind of sick to my stomach, and I thought, was that real? Did I really feel that? And so I asked Doreen. She said, I felt it too. And then I went where everybody goes to get their news. I went on to Facebook to see if anybody was talking about it on Facebook, and I saw post after post after post, and it was just, did you feel that? Did you feel that? Did you feel that? Did you feel that? And I thought to myself, this is really kind of like what it's like to be a person. I feel like being a person is just looking at other people and being like, am I crazy? Do you feel that too? Do you feel all of these feelings of like what it's like to be a person? And I think back to our story that we told on Easter, and then the story that we're going to tell today about the disciples trying to figure out what had just happened to them. Their friend had been put to death, and then their friend had come back. And I bet they were looking at each other like, do you feel that? Do you see that? Am I going nuts, or is this real? And to me, I think that's a lot like what we do here together as a community every single week. We come together to ask each other, do you feel that too? Do you feel sad sometimes? Do you feel like life is hard sometimes? Do you feel worried sometimes? Do you also feel joy? Do you feel hope? Do you feel goodness?
and it feels like a big, rumbly earth. I think that that is what life feels like. It feels like this mix of good and bad and hard and sad, and we come here each week to say, I'm not crazy, am I? Do you feel that too? And we say, yes, we feel that too. And it didn't make the earthquake go away, but it gave me a chance to share it with people. This experience that I had, this experience of feeling something weird and wild and nuts, was something that I could share with another person. And I think being in relationship with God, watching God at work in the world, is something that feels nuts and feels can make us feel crazy sometimes. But then we get to be together with each other, and we see in the faces of people that we love that they feel that too. I think that's a really special thing. Let's pray together. God, thank you for giving us this community of people that we can look at and say, do you feel this too? Is this what it feels like to be a person? To feel sad and hopeful? To feel worried and joyous? Thank you for giving us the church where we can feel that together. In your holy name we pray. Amen. It's nice to see y'all.
We have come to the time in our service where we will be offering our prayers to God. I have some people who I would like to lift before you today who are in special need of prayer. We have Gavin Mackey. We have Holly Joy Pearson and Tina Warren, Lisa Foster. We have Jeanette Bernard, Lisa Bukowski, Jean Chisholm, Jane Schneelock, Ari Isereri, and there are others on our prayer list as well that you will see printed in the back of your bulletin. I ask that in your private time of meditation and worship during the week, that you take your bulletins home with you and pray for each of these people who have needs. I also wanted to express a couple of joys that we have before us today. For many of you who were gathered here last week, you will remember that we had over 334 people in worship here at Trinity. That was a high, high celebration. I'm so glad to see you all here back for worship today. We also have things to celebrate in the life of this church. I was listening to Rob's sermon, children's sermon today, and asking, where were you during the rumble? And I was standing right there where the communion elements are at during that time with two of our trustees. And we were having a chat about the building and those kinds of things. And a big holy rumble came from our ceiling. And it echoed in this beautiful cathedral like it was a cave. And it was just amazing. I'm thankful. I'm thankful that as we walked around the building and looked at the roof and those kinds of things, that we don't think that there was any damage to our beautiful building. Praise be to God. Amen. Let us turn our hearts, our souls, and our minds inward for a few moments of silent prayer. Eternal God, we thank you for this Eastertide. We thank you for your victory over defeat and death, for rekindling our hope, for rescuing us from despair and cynicism. We thank you for the indomitable spirit of those who have gone before us. We thank you for those who have both kept the faith alive and have been kept by it. We thank you for those who have gone through the darkness and refused to succumb to it. We thank you for those who have helped resurrect our spirits by their examples and who have blessed us by believing in us when we had only hints of, but no confidence in, our own gifts. We thank you for Jesus, who lives and reigns with you both now and forevermore. Accompany us on our faith journey. Be our strength in all times of testing and trial. Be our guide when the road ahead seems veiled. Be our rock when the ground beneath us begins to shake and then whisper to us, "Peace be with you." Be our support when we doubt and waver. Be our confidence when we hear Jesus' words, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." O God, give us your Holy Spirit to direct us, to sustain us, and to fulfill our mission. Continue to resurrect our souls, temper our spirits, and fill us with compassion and love and understanding towards the least of your children. Give us a new vision of a world remade and refashioned on justice and equality. Give us the will to make it happen, and always to remember that we are under a mandate. May we hear it again, Jesus' words, "So I send you." O loving God, we offer this prayer, and we offer it in the same spirit of the one who prayed, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." And now, will you please stand in body or in spirit, and let us turn to our hymn, the hymn Now Is Open Our Eyes. You will find that in The Faith We Sing. It's on page 2086, Open Our Eyes. And we will sing this, with gusto. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture reading today is from the book of John, verses 19 through 31 in the New Testament, page 108 and 109 in the Pew Bibles. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the door of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. And welcome to the second Sunday of Easter. There are, in fact, seven Sundays of Easter. And the number seven is especially prominent in the Bible. It appears over 700 times, from the 7 days of creation to the many sevens in Revelation. The number seven connotates such concepts as completion and perfection, exoneration, healing, and the fulfillment of promises and oaths. There are seven Sundays in the season of Easter. Seven reminds us of, it stands for completion. We are at the beginning of our season, so to speak. Our lectionary text for today from the Gospel of John is one that focuses on the disciples of Jesus and while they were hiding. And it also hones in on the one that is referred to as Doubting Thomas. In the Gospel of John, it is reported that the disciples had locked themselves into a small room in Jerusalem. Because they were afraid of many things. One can only imagine the experiences that they had while they were hiding in that room and discussing and processing, discerning what's next for them. And talking about this sheer horror that they experienced of Jesus' death. They were afraid that the same thing was going to happen with them if they were found out. And they were afraid of the authorities, the religious authorities, the Romans. They just were fraught with fear. And one can only imagine how surprised they were when as they were locked behind this closed door and Jesus appeared. With the retelling of the story over the centuries, the disciples have gotten a rather bad reputation, if you will. They've gotten a rather bad reputation for their post-Easter behavior. This is especially true for the disciple Thomas. Thomas, the apostle. Thomas was also known as Didymus in Greek, which means twin. Although they refer to Thomas as being a twin, we have no idea of who this twin was. We have no idea if it was a metaphor. We have no idea what this person looked like, if this person actually existed. But Thomas is also known as Didymus, which means the twin. This apostle is also commonly known as Doubting Thomas, because he initially doubted the resurrection of Jesus. How would you like to have that moniker attached to your name? Doubting David. I mean, how would you feel if that was attached to your name? We all have doubts. Perhaps you're in a season of doubt even as I speak. But this is something that's absolutely normal for us in our journey. I have a book in my library that I treasure. It was a gift that was given to me by my homiletics professor when I graduated from seminary, the Reverend Dr. James Armstrong, who was also a retired bishop. And in this book, it is a book that has Martin Luther King's personal thoughts as he penned the words and thoughts in his Bible in the margins, as many of us do. We write and make notes and things in our Bible. And I've found over the years this has been a very, very comforting piece for me, but also very enlightening as I read the words that Martin Luther King penned in the margins of his Bible. And today I would like to share Martin Luther King's thoughts with you on Thomas. Dr. King penned these words, most enlightening. I never knew Thomas wasn't actually his name. And it makes sense that the other disciples doubted too, as they were hiding in a locked room after the crucifixion. Poor Thomas, for being viewed as the only doubter. However, once convinced, he also became the first of the disciples to explicitly acknowledge the divinity of Jesus. You may be interested in knowing that the first three Gospels say absolutely nothing about Thomas. Nothing. It is in the Gospel of John. It's in the Gospel of John that he emerges as a distinct personality. But even then, there are only 155 words about Thomas. There is not a lot written about this disciple in the Bible, but I happen to believe that he is one of the most important examples that we have. I believe that one of Thomas's spiritual gifts was the gift of clarity that he shared with the other disciples. When Jesus turned his face towards Jerusalem, which means that Jesus made his mind up that he was going to go to Jerusalem despite all of the complaining from his disciples. They were warning him that going to Jerusalem meant sheer death for him and also for themselves. But we are told that when Jesus turned his face towards Jerusalem, it was Thomas who said, "Then let us go. Let us go so that we might die with him." Thomas was also a courageous man who exhorted his fellow disciples to stay with Jesus, even though his enemies were seeking to kill him. At the Last Supper, When Jesus was preparing his disciples for his departure, Jesus said, I am going to a place prepared for you. I'm going to a place prepared for you. I will come again and receive you to myself so that we can be together. And you know where I am going. Well, the disciples were told all a bit confused, probably looking at one another. But it was Thomas who blurted out, we don't know where you are going. We don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Now, Thomas was not trying to be difficult. I believe that he was just looking for more information. It's interesting that in this story before us today that he gets his infamous nickname. But he was also the first one to confess, my Lord and my God. It's important to also understand that the title in the Roman Empire, my Lord, was reserved for when people were referring to Caesar. That was a bold statement for Thomas, my Lord and my God. These are certainly not the words of a doubter. Unfortunately, history has remembered him for the scene where the resurrected Christ made an appearance to the disciples in a home in Jerusalem. And Thomas was not present when he heard about the event. And when the disciples were sharing this exciting news that Jesus had appeared, Thomas refused to believe it. And he said, unless I feel the nail prints in his hands, I will not believe it. Now, Thomas had separated himself from the other disciples. He was not in that small room with them. And he had missed the resurrection appearance by Jesus. The theologian Frederick Buechner wrote these words. 8 days later, when Jesus did come back, Thomas was there, and Thomas got his wish. Jesus let him see him, let him hear him, let him touch him. And did not hold grievance against Thomas. Thomas had no questions left to ask, and not enough energy left to ask them. All he could say was, my Lord and my God. And Jesus seemed to consider that under the circumstances, as Frederick Buechner says, that was enough. The second time Jesus made his appearance, Thomas was present. And after Thomas believed, Jesus said to him, you have faith because you see me. Now, those are important words for our journey. Jesus was talking to Thomas, but he was talking to us as well. He said to Thomas, you have faith because you have seen me. The people who have faith without seeing me are the ones who are truly blessed. And friends, that would be 100% of us gathered here today. Jesus was saying there will be skeptics who will want to see me as you have. I would like to show them as I have shown you, but that will be impossible. They will have to believe without physical proof. According to the Gospel of John, you can depend on the fact that when you begin to doubt and fear, whether this week or next week or a decade from now, the risen Christ will not stay away from you. Our prayer can be, Lord, we believe, calm our uncertainty. After Thomas received proof he felt that he needed, he began his ministry wholeheartedly. He was, in fact, the only disciple who went outside of the Roman Empire to preach the gospel. He carried the gospel to Persia and China and India, where he was martyred near Madras in AD 72. As I mentioned earlier, Thomas was a twin. I believe that through the ages he's had many twins. In fact, each one of us could be his twin from time to time. Sometimes we find ourselves doubting like Thomas. The excitement of Easter is over. The contents of those Easter baskets have been consumed. Many people refer to this Sunday as Low Sunday. After the high of Easter, and we come back into the everydayness of life. Oftentimes it is when we are at the most low in our energy and in desire and hope that we start to entertain the most doubts. Now that we are back to normal, we believe in God, but we also sometimes wonder why God allows certain things to happen. We all need something greater to live for other than ourselves. Thomas did not mean to be obstinate. He did not want to doubt the testimonies of his friends, but he was a realist, a pragmatist. Thomas was convinced that he needed proof. Tradition holds that the apostles all went on to preach the gospel, each in their own way. Matthew suffered martyrdom when he was slain with a sword at a distant city of Ethiopia. Mark, the apostle Mark, died in Alexandria after being cruelly dragged through the streets of that city. Luke was hanged upon an olive tree in Greece. John was put in a cauldron of boiling oil, but escaped in a miraculous manner and was afterwards banished to Patmos. Peter was crucified at Rome with his upside down, with his head downward. James the Greater was beheaded in Jerusalem. James the Less was thrown from a lofty pinnacle of the temple and then beaten with a club. Bartholomew was flayed alive. Andrew was bound to a cross and he preached to his persecutors until he died. Jude was shot to death with arrows. Matthias was stoned and then beheaded. Barnabas of the Gentiles was stoned to death in Thessalonica. Paul, after various tortures and persecutions, was beheaded at Rome by Emperor Nero. And Thomas was run through the body with a lance in the East Indies. In fact, there are still Christians across India and even Iran who trace their roots to Thomas and Thomas's faithful ministry. When Jesus first asked people to follow him, those who accepted did so without being showed a roadmap for the journey. It was an open-ended invitation, and they followed because they were drawn to Jesus' teachings and trusted his leadership. It was not a journey without difficulties. Along the way, his disciples had their doubts and their questions. Jesus promised to send the Holy Spirit to those who walk by faith and not by sight. We don't need to understand how it all works to believe. There comes a time in all of our lives, like Thomas, when we move beyond a demand for proof and move ahead in faith. Do not be afraid of new knowledge. Do not be afraid of doubt. Honest doubt is the starting point for new knowledge. Can you feel it? Amen.
Holy God, we continue to hold on to the celebration and triumph of Easter. As we look back over the past year, we realize that many of us can identify with Thomas's doubt. Can we be the church, the body of Christ, when we can't see the body gathered in our sanctuary? Yet Christ has opened our eyes to this risen body that can't be confined by walls and is not diminished by precautions and social distance. We make our gifts to you. We affirm the resurrection power that we have seen, so we again can say, Alleluia. In the powerful name of Jesus we pray, Amen.
Celebrate the joy of our faith.
As we enter into this time of Holy Communion, know that you are welcomed at this table. Inspired by our expansive and inclusive God, we invite with celebration and without reservation all of God's children, every age, race, gender identity, sexual orientation, socioeconomic condition, family structure, and physical or mental ability, you are welcomed here. Now, let us begin the great Thanksgiving.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise you, your name, and join their unending hymn.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to the inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. And he gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was reorganized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread, and in the power of your Holy Spirit by your church has continued in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup.
And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as the holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. All are invited to share in this meal, this holy meal. Unfermented grape juice is used, as well as gluten bread, free for all of those who prefer to take communion from your seat and are able. Communion kits are also available to those in the back of the sanctuary. If you prefer to take communion in your seats, just please raise your hand and we will come to you. The ushers will now invite you by pew to come forward to receive communion. You are welcome to receive communion at the altar or at one of the communion stations at the bottom of the chancel steps. For those of you who are joining us online, this is your time to receive the elements. If you would like communion served to you once again in the pew, please raise your hand and we will come to you. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, O God, for this beautiful day. We give thanks to you for another day of life. We give thanks for walking with us on this journey that we call life. We know that there will be vacillations, the highs and the lows, but you have promised to walk with us throughout this journey. For you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Bless us as we travel. We give you thanks for being our traveling companion. Hold all of these in the palms of your hands. In the Spirit of Christ we pray. Amen. And now, congregation, would you please rise in body or in spirit? Let us prepare to sing our final hymn of the morning, He Lives. Have another member of the staff parish, Fred, would you please be with us in spirit?
Good morning. My name is Sarah McEwen, and I am the chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee here at Trinity United Methodist Church. For the past 3 years, our congregation has been blessed with the faithful and talented services of our Director of Music Ministries, Dr. Michael Carney. His dedication to creating a music program of high quality and diverse styles, his many talents in both music and technology, and his strong Christian values have been gifts to the Trinity community. As many of you know, we celebrated the completion of Mike's Doctor of Musical Arts degree in instrumental conducting from the University of Hartford in May 2022. Now we have some additional exciting news to share. Dr. Carney was recently offered a promotion to full professor in the instrumental music department at the College of the Holy Cross in Worcester, Massachusetts. Although it was a difficult decision for him to make because he truly enjoys working with our senior pastor, the staff, the choirs, and with the congregation, Dr. Carney has decided to accept this offer and will be leaving his position at Trinity at the end of July. We realize this is difficult news, but we hope you will join us in wishing him well in his future endeavors at the College of the Holy Cross as a full professor in the music department. You can be assured that the Staff Parish Relations Committee has been working diligently to conduct an extensive search to find a new Director of Music Ministries for Trinity, and we will keep you posted and updated with our process in the next weeks and months. Thank you.
Again, this is a high celebration for Michael. In this rare opportunity to be able to have a full professorship, especially at such a wonderful college like Holy Cross. We're thankful for him and we're going to miss him greatly. But the good news is Michael's going to be with us for a while. He'll be with us till the end of July. So please keep in your prayer list, please keep our staff parish in your prayers as we conduct a search for this position. And let us all celebrate with Michael this wonderful opportunity that he has in store. Yes, let's give him a hand, shall we? God bless you all.